Hi, John Hess from Filmmaker IQ. Today, I'm going to address a common misperception that distance plays a role in how you expose, that you need more light to light a faraway distant object than you do a near one. But first, a visit to our sponsor corner. This IQ Bits video is sponsored by the Civic Life Project and their Democracy 2020 Youth Film Challenge. If you're aged 15 to 25, create and submit a film about an issue you deeply care about in the upcoming 2020 election. My advice, look closer to home. There's probably an issue right in your backyard that needs attention. Make a documentary film about it and encourage young people like yourself to get involved and, most importantly, vote. Oh yeah, you can win $5,000. So get out there, make something great, and you might just improve the lives of you and your community. Go to civiclifeproject.org or check out the link in the description below. What a great project. Well, from exposing social and community problems to exposing for the camera, let's get back to why distance doesn't affect exposure. Now, some of you might be scratching your heads thinking, well, I never thought that would. Well, good for you. But when I was coming of age as a filmmaker, I remember watching the Citizen Kane commentary by none other than the great Roger Ebert, where he said this.
Everything from the foreground to the background in focus, the foreground backlit to give us this effective silhouette, and all the way in the background, the actress Dorothy Commingore. And Greg Toland used double arc lamps to put all that light in the background, because the further you are away from the camera, the more light there must be on you in order for you to show up. It takes less light in the foreground than in the background. And so we used big lamps that were used for Technicolor, because Technicolor needs a whole lot of light, more light than black and white, but he used...
Now hone in on that right there. The further you are from the camera, the more light must be on you in order for you to show up. It takes less light in the foreground than in the background. Well, I stored this info nugget in my brain, and when it came time to develop ideas for Filmmaker IQ videos, along with deep focus and the hyperfocal distance, I thought it might be cool to demonstrate this very concept. But the problem is, Roger Ebert was completely wrong. Now, let's clear the air, so to speak. There are atmospheric effects called aerial perspective that give distant objects a desaturated look. This is caused by particulates in the air adding up over distance. That's not what we're talking about here. What we're talking about is a misapplication of the inverse square law for light. The inverse square law says that for an isotropic point light, as you increase the distance, the light received from that light will fall off by the square of the change in distance. So it would make sense that as you increase the distance from the camera to the subject, less light from the subject will make it onto the camera sensor, therefore the exposure will be less. Makes sense, right? Well, let's set up a quick experiment. Here's my camera shooting exposure pop-up chart. We are shooting from 2 feet away. Now, without changing any camera settings, I'm just going to dolly that camera back to 8 feet. We've increased our distance by a factor of 4. Therefore, the light received back here should only be 1/16th of that from the original distance. That's 1/4 squared. But when we compare the shots, the exposures look pretty much the same, even when we zoom in digitally. Yet we are only receiving 1/16th of the light at 8 feet than we did at 2 feet. Why isn't this further shot 4 stops darker? Is the inverse square law broken? Well, not at these distances. We'll cover where it doesn't quite work right in a future video. But at these distances, it's accurate to within an error factor of less than 1%. The answer lies in the basics of what exposure actually is. Exposure is not about getting the total amount of light gathered. It's about the concentration of light in a given area. If you ever play with a light meter in spot metering mode, you'll know that the spot meter measures light in candelas per meter squared. And that's the giveaway. It's candelas, a measure of light intensity, per meter squared. That's the area. The next natural question is, how do we measure area from a vantage point? Well, let's go back to my video on the math and science of force perspective. In that lesson, we imagine our viewpoint as an angle and derived this formula for calculating the angle of view a subject occupies. Then later in the video, I showed you that the formula can actually be approximated using this simpler formula, width divided by distance. But that's only one dimension. If we want to compare the surface area from our viewpoint, called the solid angle, we need to have two dimensions, width times height. Set both width and height equal to 1, and now watch what happens. The surface area of an object in our field of view diminishes by the inverse of the square of the distance. Look familiar? The inverse square law. So when we increase the distance from our camera to the subject, the solid angle diminishes by the inverse of the square of the change in distance, exactly the same as the amount of actual light we receive. So the concept that governs diminishing light received is the exact same concept that governs the diminishing perceived solid angle. In case the concept is still a little bit undeveloped, let's attach some real-world numbers to a thought experiment. Let's say we have a square white piece of paper and a camera. At say 1 meter, the light coming off the square is enough to cover 100 pixels square, or 10,000 pixels. The light also fills each one of those pixels precisely to 100% capacity. Now let's just say that it takes 1 ligit to fill a pixel of our sensor to capacity. I completely made up that unit because it doesn't matter precisely what it is, but it's some number of lux, a ligit. We know that at 1 meter, our sensor is getting 10,000 ligits from this bright square. Now let's increase that distance from 1 meter to 10 meters. That's a tenfold increase. Now where that square covered 10,000 pixels, now it will only cover 100 pixels, 10 by 10. It still takes 1 ligit to fill the pixels to capacity. So at 10 meters, the camera is only receiving 100 ligits, which is exactly the inverse square law of light suggests. Now, how did Roger Ebert completely blow it with the Citizen Kane commentary?
Damn it, how could this have happened?
The truth is, Citizen Kane cinematographer Greg Toland did have to use big lights to accomplish some of the deep focus shots. But it's not the distance from the camera, it's the distance from the light source. Now, when the camera is very close to the subject, you can put a light fairly close to it because it'll be right out of frame. But if the camera is very, very far away and you want the light out of the shot, you have to move the light much further away from the subject. And if you move the light further away, the amount of light landing on the subject will be reduced by the inverse square law. So that scene that Ebert used in his example is probably not the one that used the big arc lamps. You can easily have hidden some lights pretty close behind that foreground wall. A shot like this, where you need to have empty space all the way to the background, would require the much bigger, powerful arc lamps in order to deliver that kind of luminous reach. And so there you have it. I spent about 10 years with this myth in my head because the most revered modern critic doesn't understand how photography actually works. Thanks, Ebert. If you like this quick dive into the aspects of filmmaking and photography, you know what to do. Hit the like, subscribe, and ring that bell. Consider becoming a patron on Patreon. Special thanks to our special A-team patrons. You guys rock. If you didn't like this video, pop over to our merch store on the shelf below and grab a Calling the Roll hoodie and burn them in a shameless effigy. Grab two and the bonfire will last longer. Again, special thanks to this video's sponsors, Civic Life Project and their Democracy 2020 Youth Film Challenge. A great project for young people to get out there and get involved in the medium of motion pictures. So what are you waiting for? Get out there, make something great. I'm John Hess. I'll see you at Filmmaker IQ.